Greetings, everyone. Welcome back to, well, a little bit more Long of the Chosen, although we're not gonna play a mission today. So, towards the end of the campaign, and with only the last mission outstanding, there is a little tradition that I like to do, which is looking back at the various classes and class builds and specs and talents that we used during the campaign, and reflecting a little bit what worked, what didn't work, what surprised me, and what kind of I'm taking home from that for future campaigns, you know? Lessons learned kind of thing. It's gonna be probably a little bit shorter than in previous times, first of all because, well, then for the base classes there are not too many changes since the last Long Wolf Chosen campaign, so no real big surprises. Second of all, I probably want to do some full like class guide videos in the not too distant future, ready for the 1.0 release version of Long War of the Chosen, and I'll keep my in-depth commentary for that, so I'm not gonna look at every single talent choice. Anyway, without further ado, you see the lineup of our assaults here. First thing that surprised me a little bit was we only had two Master Sergeant Assaults, and then a bit of a gap, and then a bunch of Tech Sergeants. Like, I think Assaults are probably still one of the strongest classes, but for some reason... Well, two Master Sergeants is not super low, right? That's actually, when we're going through the other classes later on, that's about the average, I want to say, of people who reach Master Sergeant. Then again, this gap to Tech Sergeant kind of hit me there. There's certainly multiple factors. I think that definitely Wolfie, but I also think Predator had a lot of downtime. Then I wasn't, like you see, there's no distinct build that I was going for. It's all a little bit wishy-washy. So maybe I was experimenting around a little bit too much. I think at the end of the day, this year, which I consider kind of the max damage killer instinct run and gun build, right, with a little bit trench gun for your concealment ambush or if you get in the right position, and with untouchable, and probably Street Sweeper is, I think, my go-to build for futures. Sometimes rapid fire. I think close encounters is probably most of the time even stronger. Just so that you have something for non-run-gun turns to do. That is just a little bit more flexible. What I really liked was Quick Zap, which Annie had here. So, I can actually just go like this. That felt, once we unlocked it, really strong. Like, incredibly flexible. Like, you run and gun to a position, Quick Zap one fool, and then take care of another. That seemed really good. I kind of regret that we didn't get to higher levels here to play around with the Arc Thrower build. That being said, Chain Lightning is still getting a rework, because I don't think ever since it was nerfed to give the minus 50 aim, I don't think I've ever built a soldier with it. And it is gonna get reworked, removing the aim penalty but changing the targeting, so you're not targeting everything that you see, and it's more like similar to Volt targeting, that you like target one unit and it will jump to anyone nearby, but only to a certain extent. So I think at most you can hit 4 or 5 targets. Probably still gonna be strong. I'm just not sure if it's strong enough to justify the Master Sergeant ability and going into other stun gun builds. Like, I think you probably want stun gunner for that. That means you're giving up killer instinct, and then it's getting a little bit iffy. Anyway, that's my thoughts on stun gunner build. Didn't quite work out. Then we had this. This more like defensive build with Fortify and Formidable, and I mean Formidable is great. I don't think Fortify makes too much of a difference most of the time. I think it lacked a little bit a little bit the oomph, at least until we got to like close encounters and lethal. So, while I really like Formidable, now I'm just thinking, yeah, I probably prefer Killer Instinct, but if you take Killer Instinct, you kind of have to take extra conditioning. So, and the lack of AoE, so yeah, kind of have a great trench gun, and at that point you arrive at this build again. So, yeah, I don't know. But what I really also liked here is having some more pistol skills and the way it worked with the Icarus armor, which I probably, it's more related to Icarus than pistols, but I think I'm underutilizing pistols, and that's something I'm going to keep in mind for future campaigns, just to use pistols a little bit more. What else can we look at? Maybe, since we have our two Master Sergeants here, a very quick... Nope, 26 missions, 93 kills. And over here, 25 missions with 65 kills. Probably not the highest kill counts we see here. So yeah, those are our thoughts. Let's go over to the next guys. Okay, and next in the alphabet is the Grenadier, which you could almost get the impression that this was the discussion of the officers. No, it was really my go-to officer pick has been in the past the support Grenadier with exactly this kind of spec here that you see. It's kind of zigzaggy spec, going to salvo, going to full kit, rapid deployment, blue screen, while picking up heat for some extra shredding and picking the heavy ordnance, because you know, if you double a grenade it might as well be an expensive one. I still think it's a strong build. My biggest takeaway though from not necessarily actually this campaign but rather the Twitch campaign I played late at the same time is that I've been really sleeping on needle grenades, because that was buffed compared to previous Long War of the Chosen campaigns that I played. Plus one bonus damage to unarmored enemies. Suddenly this is a really strong pick and enables like a damage grenadier build that just goes pretty much top row all the time, except for Needle instead of Zapper, and probably Full Kit instead of Combat Engineer. And we could have a 2-hour discussion between heat warheads and tandem warheads. I'll keep that for the actual class guide video. It's kind of like, so we tried a little bit a damage grenadier build here with Gia. I just don't like Zapper. It's such a terrible perk. It's like you get some more environmental damage, but not really to make it reliable, so using grenades to destroy cover still doesn't work until you have both Zapper and Combat Engineer. And that's such a long and painful road to actually get there, where you're not as used, like you're bringing him for cover destruction, but he can't actually do cover destruction until Master Sergeant. That's just feels so full. I'm not sure what the solution is for environmental damage in Long War of the Chosen. I just feel like it's not it. Like from the previously mentioned Twitch campaign where we built like damage grenadiers with Needle, tandem, and then full kit, they were among our highest kill counts in the campaign. Like, who needs to destroy cover when you just kill the guys who are standing behind the cover with your grenade, right? So yeah, that was quite fun. Anyway, in this specific campaign, it worked. Like, this is a solid build. You've got your sting grenades, you've got your officer abilities, you've got action economy out the wazoo with rapid deployment and salvo. So you can like launch a sting grenade, launch a fire grenade, and then still command somebody. I mean, I still think it's solid. There is then some conflict when you bring in the damage grenadiers, like, do you bring two grenadiers in the squad? Or do you find someone else to take over the officer role? But that's a separate discussion, I think, to be had. So no complaints here, worked fine. And only downside is I didn't have a high aim grenadier, which I really like then for lead by example, but you know, maybe next time. Right, let's move on to the next class. Which brings us to the gunners. Now this is a class where I'm feeling like I have my build that I really enjoy and that I very rarely change up anything, right? We had two Master Sergeants, although I think our Gunnery Sergeant here right, was very, very close to also being our third Master Sergeant. And I also think that Rebecca saw lots of action, so I don't think we underutilized Gunners anyway. For me, they are like the main Shredder class late game to really defeat Sector Bots, Gatekeepers, Andromedons, anything that has high armor. So yeah, my kinda default build is actually not really here anymore. So it's mostly related to Center Mass, Formidable, Shredder, Chain, Cyclic, Rupture, and then probably going into Saturation Fire. And that is for me like the for every opportunity you have something. Especially Cyclic Fire has been vastly improved compared to the way it was in Long War 2. With only 2 turn cooldown, only using 3 ammo, and I think it's only minus 10 to aim. It's just really good. Chain shot, a lot of people don't like chain shot and just say rapid fire is better, but for one, what else are you gonna pick up here? And for two, I think it comes at a great timing to deal with stuff like heavy mechs. Or even depending on when you get it, even regular mechs, anything, you just need to delete stuff that doesn't have super high defense. Berserkers, great example also. So that's generally my kind of go-to build. And yeah, having some source of rupture in the squad seems really good, so that's my kind of prefer rupture over rapid fire. And I think with rapid fire, you just have too many multi-shot abilities. We had a little variation. Well, first of all, we picked up kill zone instead of the multi-shot abilities here, which it worked great, and a kill zone lock and load is fantastic. Bring him on for additional crit damage on the kill zone also worked fairly well, I think. It just felt then whenever your chain shot is on cooldown, you're kind of sitting there and have not much to do. Like only firing a single shot per turn when your other stuff is on cooldown, then you might as well bring a spark. So I'm not sure. I think probably maybe instead of combat fitness, I should have gone for saturation fire to have at least something else to do. Maybe for traverse fire. I don't know. I like kill zone. I just feel it's maybe too situational to pick it up all the time. And it probably also then depends on what your squad composition looks like and who you're usually cruising around with. Then one other small change we had over here, where I picked demolition over chain shot. And I think we used demolition, I want to say, maybe 3 times through the campaign. It was always good when we used it, but I felt chain shot was kind of missing. So that's probably... And I don't want to say demolition is bad, I just feel like sometimes you just need something to unload on a single target after a move, when you can't use cyclic fire, and that's where chain shot is really good. Yeah, I mean, knife skills... It's fun and all, but yeah, I kind of, part of me wishes, you know, get rid of all that suppression stuff and just give me a full knife spec here. But yeah, just iron curtain, nobody needs that. Throw out some bad abilities and give me a knife build. Although I think that would be too much to ask. But yeah, other than that, Gunners, solid, good damage dealers, main source of shredding for me personally, and it's probably also one of the reasons why I don't like suppression build, because then you are not picking up shredder, and then it kind of becomes much weaker. And I think especially with the chosen, being able to cyclic fire shredder then, that felt good. Okay, moving on to the next class. One little thing I forgot about when looking at our gunners is a mission and kill count here. And so for our master sergeants, that is. That's not where you looked at that. 26 with 57 kills for Andy. This is, by the way, pre-network tower, so yeah, the first time we actually utilized fully the kill zone, so that's a few more coming to that counter. And Paulo, 2763, very similar level. I don't think we had that many opportunities for great saturation fires. And I think that's like in previous campaigns where our saturation fire gunners were really leading the kills count, that was mostly related to global liberation and having supply raid and HQ assault after supply raid and HQ assault and saturating everything that comes into the site. Alright, now we go on to the next class. Well, we are coming to Psyonix here, which, as you can already see by the ranks, nobody made it to the final rank. I don't think Psyonix are weak, I think it's really just a matter of when in your campaign you get to them. In the previously mentioned Twitch campaign, I kinda did a Psy rush, getting the Psy lab out as one of the first buildings, and then we had a lot of Psy, active Psy soldiers in the squads. Felt good, was fairly strong. Didn't feel overpowering, and maybe it's too risky to do that always, that kind of strategy, but definitely more action than we saw on the Psyonix in this little adventure. But yeah, I mean, I like the new Psy abilities. The way Fuse works now, being a free action, is really great. Face walk is super cool, super fun, allows for some interesting tactics with like shotgun Psyonix, which we had. Solace is okay. Soulstorm, hot garbage, I don't know. It's you could remove that ability and I wouldn't miss anything. That's kind of really disappointing. Like if you go for damaging abilities, it's gotta be your Null Lance, maybe your Void Rift. Although also, I always felt Void Rift is a little bit low on the damage side. Yeah, I don't know. It's I always felt in previous campaigns that you kind of need Psyonix in the late game for Mind Spin, for Insanity Spam to deal with Archons, etc. I could have probably gone away with not building a Psylab at all the whole campaign and wouldn't have felt much difference. So kind of a thing of if you focus on them early enough, they can grow really strong, but they're not necessary. Like you can also play a campaign without any Psyonix at all and you're not missing out. So which I think is okay for a class position to be in. Yep, that's all I think I'm gonna say for Psyonix. Let's move on to the next one. Which brings us to the Rangers. Interesting things here. First of all, three Master Sergeants and two Gunnery Sergeants. And that's it. Like, we don't have any low-ranking Rangers somewhere in the barracks that never see action. If you're a Ranger, you're on missions. A lot. Also, what surprised me even more, two of our three Master Sergeants are pump action builds, both barrels. It's probably more like a thing where I build at most one soldier like that in previous campaigns, but I'm really starting to like that much more. Of course, scrap metal is fantastic XCOM perk that just enables that build even more. But even without it, I think you can do some significant damage. What we didn't see too much, I feel, the whole Overwatch rapid reaction build. Let me just zoom in here. Whether or not you take Gathering Fire or Locked On is a separate discussion for a different video. I think maybe we played like two missions where we actually had rapid reaction and taken advantage of this. My experience with previous campaigns was always that Overwatch Rangers are really strong once you get them to Gunnery Sergeant, and that's a really late peak. Like, most other classes have their class defining abilities on these two ranks. Like, you know, Tech Sergeant for Assaults, for example, is all your rapid fire, close encounters, hidden run, this kind of stuff. Having to wait until Gunnery Sergeant to actually become super strong is a tricky one. So to a point where I'm actually thinking, do I wanna have Overwatch Rangers? Or do I just want to build Shooty and, if the stats allow it, both barrels ranges? Probably something to think about in future campaigns. Yeah, so this is my Shooty Ranger build. No big surprises here. I was musing a little bit in some videos, I think, about going full crit infantry, kind of with aggression, bring them on and get even more damage out of it. I don't think you need it, and I think Implacable is such a key piece in that build to enable you to always be in a position to take your shot and then your rapid fire, getting three shots off every turn. It's just kind of the workhorse of the team, the Shooty Ranger, I think. Solid damage, reliable, accurate, especially with the Locked On an Executioner being 20-20 instead of 10-10, what it was in Long War 2. For me, just a fun spec to play, fun soldier class. And yeah, I know there's a lot of people like hating on Rangers. I don't see that. I think that's just very strong class. Which also is reflected here. About same amount of missions as our gunners, about twice the number of kills. Could say, oh, that's just a kill stealer class, but I don't think so. I don't think that's a fair comparison. What are you looking at here? 1645, not quite as much. 35, 133, highest kill count so far. Which actually surprises me. So yeah, that's the whole pump action build. I mean, having 21 mobility certainly helps making this build work. Alright, yeah, that's that. That's all I have to say for Rangers. Great class, good fun to play. Let's go to the next one. The next one being the Sharpshooters. And, well, first of all, this is the class with four Master Sergeant soldiers in the barracks. So, I guess the most used class, or maybe they get the most promotions because, you know, to the high XP missions like HQ Assault, I'd like to bring two Sharpshooters at least. So maybe we'll get more promotions like that, but I also think as long as your squad is working correctly, you can still level them up fairly easily late game. Like our little sergeant here, we brought him on some really end game missions and he was still performing well. I think he wasn't he on the, not the black side, maybe an alien facility, maybe it was some other thing. Yeah, anyway, so that was all great. Standard build Well, either you're a holo-targeting officer or you're Death from Above sharpshooter. There's no other spec that you can use for sharpshooter. Here's a hot take. I kind of felt parts of the campaign that disabling shot felt even stronger than Kubikiri back in the day. Because it's so much more versatile. Like, it also has an effect if it doesn't crit. Like, if it crits and, well, it can't crit technically, but if it would roll an effective crit, you stun them for 2 turns, which is just super strong. But even if you just hit, which generally with your aim you will do, you just take them out of the action for a turn. Sure, you still need to get the damage in, but getting damage in is not the problem. Getting like taking care of the enemy this turn is the problem, and stunning them and then setting them aside so that you can focus them next turn solves a lot of problems. So I think this enables then also, since you no longer have Kubikiri here, you don't need aggression, which gives you another strong cooldown ability with Deadeye. It felt even stronger. I don't know. It sounds weird. I know Kubikiri is kind of broken with the, oh, I one-shot the enemy, but I think it always required a lot of setup with, like, holo-targeting maybe, or get some, and then you have a 98% chance to crit, and it's still not guaranteed that you actually destroy the enemy. And here you're just, oh, I just run over there and disabling shot that guy. No big deal. As long as I hit, it's fine, and if we can just kill everything this turn, focus that sector port or that gatekeeper next turn, we win. Anyway, so one thing I've really come around to is that I prefer now double tap over AMF. I think in the past I really almost always went for AMF. I think it's still a valid choice, especially what did we go for here? Yeah, because of rapid fire, even though that not working with squad side is a big scam. Scammed out of my 30 AP here. Should be in the tooltip. But yeah, I think double tap is just solid because it also, you kill something and then you stun something with your second shot or so. Good choices here. Biggest letdown of the campaign? Screwing up the officer promotion and not getting lead by example here with 107 aim sharpshooter. Big mistake. That would have been such a big addition to the squad. Like, lead by example, high aim, hollow targeting sharpshooter can really do wonders. Not like we needed it, it's not like we lost any missions because of it, but yeah. Yeah, not much else to say. I mean, quick look though, kill count is, I want to say, slightly below our rangers, our top rangers for Spana. Everybody else is even lower than that, despite having even more missions. Oh, was it? I think it was 36 for Spana, and Helena has, I think, 21, 74, like, high kills per missions, but not, at the end of the day, not the super high kill count. Not sure what else to say. Something in the back of my mind, yeah. So equipment, grappling suit is for me, like, everybody needs that with your sniper. I see so many people, oh, they are so expensive, and then at the same time saying snipers are useless on timed missions, and it's like, yeah, put one and one together, they are useless on timed mission because you don't spend the money for a grappling suit. I think with a grappling suit you can bring them to any mission. They can easily reposition, always get a flanking or a great shot from high ground, enable your DFA. Just problem solvers in my book. Anyway, enough about the snipers. Or sharpshooters, I should say. I think specialists are next. Looks like I need to look at my ABCs. Before we go to the specialists, we come to the shinobis, after the sharpshooters. So, yeah, 5 master sergeants, 1 high-ranking gunnery sergeant. Definitely the class that saw the most action, and probably also, if we look here in a second, or let's look now, fairly high kill counts. Well, only on our shooty shinobi, with 85. You probably, yeah, barely 1 kill per mission. Okay, Amy has a high kill count, at least, yeah, almost 4 kills per mission. So, yeah, what is there to say? You see 4 people with the short sword spec, just Kenshiro all the way through, and that's solid. You have your scout, and once you're done scouting, you bring them out of concealment and you murder fools. And since I do like my support officers with flashbang grenades or sting grenades, that enables CDG for some really nice extra damage against stunned and disoriented targets. So, mess problem solvers, you could say. And then we have our one and only shooty shinobi, which takes advantage of, it's basically all around the idea that hunter's instincts plus 2 damage against flanked enemies, and with pistol skills you can take 1 plus fanfire, that's 4 shots, plus hit and run 5 shots, plus rapid fire 7 shots if you have enough flanked targets, and that's 14 extra damage each and every single turn. That's even stronger if you have something like center mass also here in your XCOM skill roll, and well, you kind of need high aim to really enable that. It's a little bit slow, but once you reach tech sergeant, you hit and run, suddenly it pops off, and it's really expensive on the XCOM perks. I still like it. I'm not sure, like, the most disappointing thing this campaign about my shinobis has been Bladestorm. I think it's an unjustified nerf that you can no longer trigger Bladestorm on your own turn, and taking away my Bladestorm activations makes me just a sad panda. To a point where I was even thinking, do I need Bladestorm on my sword shinobis, because it's at the end of the day it triggers so rarely. It's great against the Lost, that's pretty much it. On the other hand, what else are you gonna pick up? Low profile? Probably not. So yeah, a lack of alternatives, I would say. Then we have our one stealthy shinobi here as an officer, and I still would say that's like the one guy in your whole barracks where you can do that with. It's worth building one stealth shinobi with Ghostwalker and Covert. I mean, mostly we use them for the network tower mission, sneak through to the objective, easily clear that, get the hack, get the stun, clear the network tower. Has advantages in some like supply raids or HQ assaults, just staying concealed, providing information to the target, but of course very little firepower added to the squad, so kind of the rest of the squad needs to make up for that. But if you have a squad that actually takes advantage of the continuous stealthed scouting, maybe due to snipers, maybe due to overwatches that you can set up, you can make it work. Still probably wouldn't build more than one stealth shinobi in a single campaign. Right, specialists are next. This time for Rhea. Right, here we are with our specialists, four master sergeants, one gunnery sergeant, so also a class with a lot of action. Obviously, because you want to bring them to, you know, hack your objectives, get the bonus rewards. You also have a lot of control of mechanical enemies, and I think mid-game, once you have skull mining, just always running out there with a skulljack and making sure you get that one skulljack in permission is just the main and basic intel income. And that's something I sometimes forget that I need to do that in the Proving Ground. Like, there's this part of my brain which is like, yeah, no, we don't want to skulljack a codex. I don't want to unlock codex as an enemy. I don't want to advance the mission. But yeah, don't worry about it. Just get skull mining and skull mine one target each mission. Having that free intel for some more boosts, for more contacts is just worth it. You can see definitely a trend when it comes to all the skill trees, so pretty much Sentinel Ever Vigilant Overwatch guys. I'm still not sure, still not sold on Killzone on the Specialist. Then again, Specialist, Master Sergeant perks are like, might as well pick Killzone because the other two aren't worth it either. Then we had Jason with, I don't even know what to call this. It's like all the stuff from the hacker row, except it's not really hacking, and even our overwatchers pick up Trojan and full override. I also feel like the hacker tree for specialists needs something that gives you more hack score. Like, really, that enables you hacking, and not like failsafe is such a disappointing tech sergeant perk. I don't know. Not a fan. That should really just, if you fail, no negative effects, and you get plus 30 hacking. Suddenly it's a solid pickup. Yeah, and then the age-old discussion of airdrop versus ever vigilant. Probably then also mostly depends on what kind of squad you're running with. I think Alias was in the squad with our damage grenadier, so that was the idea behind airdrop. We didn't use it all that much. Pretty much same similar thing here. As for effectiveness, 2868, that's I think similar mission and kill counts to what our gunners had. So yeah, they can be strong, although you have to keep in mind 84 aim is probably rather exceptional for a master sergeant. You probably end more like in the high 70s. And that's for late game enemies, this Overwatch spec becomes less and less reliable. So it's not the absolute killer, and you always run into issues with equipment slots. Like most of the guys in like any other class is usually running with an ablative and a vest, and then for example an ammo type. And here you need that equipment slot for the skulljack. It kind of comes natural to give your specialist the medkit, even though they have no ability to boost it, at least in my case here. So not sure why I'm in that habit. And that means you're not having ammo, which makes your killing power even less pronounced. And you don't have a vest, which means you are a little bit more vulnerable. But still, solid backbone of the squad. And yeah. Specialists. Don't leave home without them. Alright, I think we've got a little bit left to go. Let's see. Ah yes, the technical. With two master sergeants and then a drop off to a bunch of tech sergeants. And that was even just you're just a tech sergeant because you ran a bunch of covered actions. Interestingly enough though, our two master sergeants are one flamer and one rocket technical, so there's no like distinct favorite kind of type of spec that I'm going for. Although I have to say, of course, with the run and gun here, what we've been able to do with the Flamer Technical has just been fun and amazing, and a lot of utility just really from picking up run and gun. So that was good fun to be had. I still think, even though some people, I'm thinking of one specific person, likes to disagree here, that rocket technicals are useless. I think that's still a solid pickup. You get your accurate rockets, you get your double rockets, you get your long range rockets with Javelin, and the Blaster Gauntlet especially, but even the Mark II Gauntlet, the rockets have really high environmental damage, so cover destruction. So we talked about cover destruction with the Grenadier, and I think even the second tier Gauntlet is better than a Grenadier that has both Sapper and Combat Engineer. And the Blaster Gauntlet then even better still. So reliable cover destruction, and if you want even more cover destruction, we've got you covered with Bunker Buster. One thing, I think in the past, even on my Flame Technicals, I would pick up Bunker Buster. I'm so happy though that I picked up Firestorm here. We actually got a lot of use out of it. I think though it was changed in Long War of the Chosen, and lots of the environmental destruction was removed from Firestorm, which has its advantages and has its downsides, so be aware of that. But yeah, the problem I think with technical is they're super strong early game. You know, Flamethrower Ambush is reliable, but then if you, they kind of ended up often the first soldier I would remove from a squad if I needed to make the timer, and at that point you're either already high rank and made yourself valuable enough to remain in the squad, or you're probably one of the first ones I remove when I need to make the timer, and then you don't level up, and it's kind of a vicious circle at that point. So that's why we only ended up with two high ranking technicals and no others. Kill count, I mean, you're more setting people on fire and others then steal the kills. And you're kinda removing people's cover and others steal the kills, although you still have a fairly high kill count because I tend to also then have high aim for my rocket technicals, and so thankfully also with picking up light 'em up, you actually did a lot of shooting and did a lot of damage. One thing I would probably change here, I think picking up Salvo, even though you only have two rockets, is still better than Quick Burn. Like, Quick Burn was kind of nice to have the additional option, but I think I prefer Salvo in future campaigns. What else? We did have Concussion Rocketeer. It's still garbage. Never again. Like, this is, I swear, this is the last campaign I ever pick up Concussion Rocket. That piece of hot garbage. Anyway, yeah, technicals make things go boom, make things burn, and enable the rest of the squad. Good class. Alright, I think then we have one more. Not two more lineups to go through. Which brings us to, you know, the people that are special. So I throw them all together in this one, so not a single class, but here our hero classes and then also our Spark. So where do we start? I think a big issue always with the hero classes is, well, there is of course a bit of a bias depending on which class you start with. So we started with a Reaper, and I think the Skirmisher was the one we got the last class we got, kind of. And so that's why, since I have my kind of fixed squad structures, it's then I'm not flexible enough to get them in there. I can say from the experiences of the Twitch campaign that I'm like, Skirmisher is my favorite hero class by far. I think they have so much utility with with combat presence and menu override. Starting off with Hidden Run is super strong. I really like the way Untouchable or now Battlefield Awareness and Reflex work together, so you often end up with three actions per turn. So yeah, it was just fun to play, especially well, in this case we don't have the XCOM skills to support that, but if you get some lucky rolls here, with stuff that gives you additional aim on flank targets or additional aim after you moved, they can really destroy enemies. Like, that's so great. Also, Full Throttle, I think we had one mission on the stream campaign again where like our skirmisher ended up with like 30 mobility because he was just killing stuff every turn, two or three targets, and it was just stacking up the mobility points. Yeah, I didn't play around too much with other stuff. I can't see maybe something with a grenade build and then also having this as an officer where you then, similar to our grenadier officers, you throw your grenades and then you still can command somebody and combat presence or something, somebody. Maybe with higher willpower, then also with judgment. There's some stuff you can do here. I'm still a little bit, you know, Battle Lord Interrupt, I think, are abilities that I still haven't used ever, like since War of the Chosen came out. That always seemed like, that seems too complicated. You get actions on the enemy turn instead of Overwatch. How does that actually work? Will it work? How does it interact with other abilities? That's too complex, and I'll just take something else. And Battle Lord is kind of similar, except that it's not relying on Overwatch. I don't even know. I think it can be super strong, but also I like to be in control and not giving enemies turns, right? So kind of activating Battle Lord and then seeing that they take actions and hopefully having a meaningful reaction on my side. Seems a little bit too giving too much control to the enemy, and then I'd rather take abilities that just allow me to kill everybody. And the final word then on the middle row here. I have a very secret disgust for Wrath, just because it's a movement ability, but it still requires a hit roll. So imagine just you stand in position, you want to Wrath to an enemy, then shoot him, then run somewhere else with Hidden Run, and you miss your Wrath. Then you're still standing in your starting position, except you're down in action, and this thing is on cooldown, and good luck being useful that turn. So having a movement ability which you can't control which tile you move to, and that can also then miss, is just for me too unreliable. Like, XCOM is all about removing the RNG, getting those 100% shots. And I don't need an additional RNG when it comes to my movement. Like, if a shinobi misses a slash, at least he's standing next to the enemy and I can give him a command and he can try again. If I miss my Wrath, I'm still at my starting point, and even if you command me, I can't get there where I wanted to go to, because, you know, it's on cooldown. So I don't know, maybe I just have to try at some point and then be disappointed instead of being disappointed before selecting the abilities. I just think this is much stronger, much more reliable, and that's my first choice. Anyway, lots of talk about a class that didn't even make it to Master Sergeant this campaign. What else? Should I go there? Templar. You made it to Master, 21 missions, 46 kills, and I generally like the rework of the Templar with, you know, the whole shield thing and one for all and all that jazz. That seems okay. I still think I'm not in a position to really make an educated, have an educated opinion about the whole ability tree, because I haven't played enough with it. I think Invert is super strong. I think you need something for focus generation, which is either aptitude, channel, or indomitable. Otherwise, you're not gonna have enough focus for doing all the things you wanna do. I also think all the master abilities are kind of crap, and not something I'm excited about getting. They cost too much focus for too little effect. What else? Yeah, and Crusader's Rage is something I'll never pick up, because there were too many missions where I was standing out in the open, one for all, and the enemy shot at some other soldier who had defense. And like, if I can't reliably control the enemy fire, then I don't want an ability which requires me to take enemy fire in the first place. Anyway, for most of the time I would say this was mostly about having someone with Invert, especially against the Chosen, super helpful. But at the same time also, I remember a Chosen retaliation against the Hunter, where we didn't have any enemies on the map at the start, and we were just running after the Hunter and never doing anything, because without focus you can't Invert. So maybe you need like some sort of ability to start with one point of focus, maybe with advanced gauntlets that you start the mission with one focus. Not being able to do half the stuff that you can do at the start of a mission feels kind of underwhelming. But yeah, fun to play. I'm looking forward to playing around with some more. Like, I think Stunstrike is strong. I think Shield Bash is strong. I think there's a valid option to go for Void Condit or Fortress. Arcwife can go. Suck it. And yeah, Bladestorm, I already complained about on the Shinobi side that it just doesn't feel good anymore. On the other hand, Terrorize, so that's again to me so weird. Based on the Psy offense, it's not like you can pick who you turn into a Templar, right? You end up with a Psy offense that you didn't select that soldier. Oh, he has Psy offense, I want to make him a Templar, take advantage of Terrorize. You just take what you can get, and that's 22 here, and that's what? 32 here, and I don't know, it seems like weird scaling. Alright, enough about Templar, let's go over here, Reaper. I think this is gonna be my kind of future build most of the time. I'm not sure about Death from the Wolf. I think Impersonal Edge, reducing the shadow cooldown, might actually be the better choice here. I don't even remember how often we took advantage of Death from Above. I really like the way the knife build plays. I like having that early ghost grenade, like screw blue screen knives. That's not a competition here. Like, ghost grenade enables so much stuff for the rest of your squad. It's not even funny. Like, it's not just related to like shadow strike shenanigans, but any sort of concealment ambush. Having that twice per mission, if it's a flamethrower, a trench gun, or just letting them run into your overwatch, it's just solid. And you know, the whole, we haven't respect to the thing where now everybody gets tracking at squaddy level. As it's just super strong. That's like I said, Skirmisher is my favorite class, but it's just barely ahead of the Reaper. Like, Reapers are just good. And I also feel like they have really strong XCOM role perks. Like, I already picked up 3 and I could easily see myself picking up 2 more. If I had even more AP. There's also things you can do with like the pistol build. With like Gunslinger, I think it is. You know, reaction shot that's guaranteed to hit and crit with pistol against any enemy that moves or attacks within 8 times. So I think there was some shenanigans you can do where you like position yourself close to a pot on the turn when your shadow runs out and go into activate Gunslinger, so then at the start of your turn you lose shadow but you're still in Gunslinger and it triggers, I think. Feel free to correct me if I'm wrong. It's just like things I heard about but I haven't really tested myself. So yeah, lots of interesting shenanigans you can do. And of course, we created Chosen because of Rent the Marked, and that felt good. Right, I guess I have to say something about a Spark. Wasn't terrible. Certainly, though, in my opinion, something where you can just save yourself the money and not build it. Big investment. Probably if you like build multiple Sparks and then also can swap the weapons around, etc., you get much more value out of it. Because just, you know, you build the Spark weapon and then you kind of have... It would make sense to then bring the Spark on missions whenever they're available. Biggest downside for me really is they can't bond with other soldiers, so no advantage of teamwork. And kind of when you don't have overdrive available, they are like running around and shooting once with the weapon. That and override is a fairly long cooldown. Not on cooldown. Like, so you 3 turns where you only just take a single shot. Or you go into Overwatch and hope that you can get multiple shots off. It's not enough in my book to really make it my first pick on any kind of mission. I know there's a lot of silly stuff you can do with Hunter Protocol and Sentinel and threat assessment from a specialist, but I feel that's just gimmicky at that point. And I'm a fan of gadgets. Anyway, that's a Spark. It's not bad. It's just not my favorite kind of thing. It's like, it's okay. You can use them. They will help out the team. They have a really, like, the weapon. Where are we? Not abilities. Loadout. Illyrian Face Cavern is, I'm fairly certain, the strongest weapon in the game. Or maybe the heavy cannon from a gunner is just as strong, 10 to 15. But still, it's not enough, in my opinion, with override, having that only every 4 turns or so. So, yeah. Max. Okay, I think we do one more. Having a quick look at just our officers. So, these are the 6 officers we had in this campaign. I mean, most of them I already kind of commented on when we were looking at individual classes, so no big surprises here. My main focus when selecting an officer is always a little bit the action economy. Like, the defining officer ability for me is always command, so being able to give someone else an action. So then the question is, can you do something useful with your turn and then still command an enemy? And that is for my Grenadiers, Rapid Deployment and Salvo. For my Holobot Sharpshooters, it's Rapid Targeting or just normal High Def Holo and then being able to command. Well, and I guess for my shinobi, it's taking a blue move and scouting and then commanding. I think most of the time it was rather teamworking your bond mate and letting them do a lot of damage. When it comes to officer abilities itself, I think we have I wanted to say two trial by fire officers, but I think I only see it once here. I think in the future probably better. No, yeah, we had it. No, we had it twice. Yeah, you generally want trial by fire on whoever your first officer is. Doesn't matter which class. The first officer that reaches that rank, take trial by fire, level up your barracks, and then maybe have a second one to, you know, also level up your barracks. Helps especially with psionics, which we didn't really take advantage of. Alternatively, then I think I need to look at the actual officer tree. Yeah, then on everybody else you take Gemma and then always forget to use it, so that's a reliable kind of thing. Make sure you use lead by example if you have someone with high aim and you want them to like give some of that aim to the rest of the squad. You would regret not taking that on your holo targeting sharpshooter with high aim. Anyway, this is kind of the first two ranks, I think, is a bit of a wash. Do whatever you want to take. I think there's nothing you can do wrong or right here. I kind of prefer the right side, but I can see some value in the guys stuff on the left. This is for me then, well, yeah, connector on anyone who's not lead by example, fire discipline 100% of the time. Unless you're really running a squad, like if you have fixed squads, and I most of the time have that, and you have a squad that doesn't rely on Overwatch at all, then you might take Defilade. I just think being able to kill enemies on Overwatch before they are a problem is more valuable than 5 more defense. And then the last two, this is always Infiltrator. There's no good argument for Air Controller ever. Like, if you make it this far into the campaign without having problems with your evac, then you don't need a two turns faster evac. Although, one thing I want to know. Okay, it's the minimum time that this guy can rotate to. I forgot to get any bonuses. Redeploying evac zone during the mission is a two-turn wait time for the Sky Ranger. I wonder if you have Air Controller, if you can just willy-nilly redeploy it without any waiting time. Maybe worth testing at some point. I still think, though, Infiltrator is just so good in order to get big squads into those late game missions. And then here, I think I always went with Combined Arms, even though there was a bit of a drought for Alloys in Illyrium late game, so getting a little bit more might have been great, but plus one damage on everybody, on every successful attack. Especially combine it then with any kind of multi-shot attacks or AoE attacks, like your Saturation Fire or like your stealth shinobi, shooty shinobi doing his 7 attacks per turn, that's plus 7 damage per turn, that's nothing to sneeze at. And why would you sneeze at your screen anyway? Alright, so yeah, this is kind of my officer squad. As I mentioned already when discussing the Grenadiers, with my newfound curiosity on damage Grenadiers, we might see fewer support Grenadier officers in the future, and then I'm almost already kind of thinking who else might be good officer candidates. Already mentioned like grenade skirmishers might be a good choice. Yeah, and then I don't know. We had a psionic officer in the Twitch campaign that was solid and felt good. We also had a support specialist officer and that felt really bad, and please don't ever make me do that again. Anyway, That's our officers, that's our class review, class spec discussion, random string of thoughts out of my mind. I'm done here. We'll go into the final mission, Leviathan. That will be tomorrow's episode. For now, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.